The Stars, My Destination by Alfred Bester. Chapter 1. He was 170 days dying and not yet dead. He fought for survival with the passion of a beast in a trap. He was delirious and rotting, but occasionally his primitive mind emerged from the burning nightmare of survival into something resembling sanity. Then he lifted his mute face to eternity and muttered, "What's the matter, me? Help you heals. Help is all." Blasphemy came easily to him. It was half his speech, all his life. He had been raised in the gutter school of the 25th century and spoke nothing but the gutter tongue. Of all brutes in the world, he was among the least valuable alive and the most likely to live. So he struggled and prayed in blasphemy, but occasionally his raveling mind leapt backward 30 years to his childhood and remembered a nursery jingle. Gallifoyle is my name, and Terra is my nation. Deep space is my dwelling place, and death's my destination. He was Gallifoyle, mechanic's mate, third class, 30 years old, big-boned and rough, and 170 days adrift in space. He was Gallifoyle, the oiler, wiper, bunkerman, too easy for trouble, too slow for fun, too empty for friendship, too lazy for love. The lethargic outlines of his character even showed in the official merchant marine records. Foyle, Gulliver, AS-128/127:006. Education, none. Skills, none. Merits, none. Recommendations, none. Personal comments. A man of physical strength and intellectual potential, stunted by lack of ambition. Energizes at minimum. The stereotype common man. Some unexpected shock might possibly awaken him, but psych cannot find the key. Not recommended for promotion. Foyle has reached a dead end. He had reached a dead end. He had been content to drift from moment to moment of existence for 30 years, like some heavily armored creature, sluggish and indifferent. Gallifoyle, the stereotype common man. But now he was adrift in space for 170 days, and the key to his awakening was in the lock. Presently it would turn and open the door to Holocaust. The spaceship, Nomad, drifted halfway between Mars and Jupiter. Whatever war catastrophe had wrecked it had taken a sleek steel rocket, 100 yards long and 100 feet broad, and mangled it into a skeleton on which was mounted the remains of cabins, holds, decks, and bulkheads. Great rents in the hull were blazes of light on the sun side, and frosty blotches of stars on the dark side. The SS Nomad was a weightless emptiness of blinding sun and jet shadow, frozen and silent. The wreck was filled with a floating conglomerate of frozen debris that hung within the destroyed vessel like an instantaneous photograph of an explosion. The minute gravitational attraction of the bits of rubble for each other was slowly drawing them into clusters, which were periodically torn apart by the passage through them of one survivor still alive on the wreck, Gulliver Foyle, AS-128/127:006. He lived in the only airtight room left intact on the wreck, a tool locker off the main deck corridor. The locker was 4 feet wide, 4 feet deep, and 9 feet high. It was the size of a giant's coffin. 600 years before, it had been judged the most exquisite Oriental torture to imprison a man in a cage that size for a few weeks. Yet Foyle had existed in that lightless cage for 5 months, 20 days, and 4 hours. "Who are you?" "Gallifoyle is my name." "Where are you from?" "Terra is my nation." "Where are you now?" "Deep space is my dwelling place." "Where are you bound?" "Death's my destination." On the 171st day of his fight for survival, Foyle answered these questions and awoke. His heart hammered and his throat burned. He groped in the dark for the air tank which shared his coffin with him and checked it. The tank was empty. Another would have to be moved in at once. So this day would commence with an extra skirmish with death, which Foyle accepted with mute endurance. He felt through the locker shelves and located a torn space suit. There was only one aboard Nomad, and Foyle no longer remembered where or how he had found it. He had sealed the tear with emergency spray, but had no way of refilling or replacing the empty oxygen cartridges on the back. Foyle got into the suit. It would hold enough air from the locker to allow him 5 minutes in vacuum. No more. Foyle opened the locker door and plunged out into the black frost of space. The air in the locker puffed out with him, and its moisture congealed into a tiny snow cloud that drifted down the main deck corridor. Foyle heaved at the exhausted air tank, floated it out of the locker, and abandoned it. 1 minute was gone. He turned and propelled himself through the floating debris toward the hatch to the ballast hold. He did not run. His gait was the unique locomotion of free fall and weightlessness. Thrust with foot and elbow and hand against deck, wall and corner, a slow motion darting through space, like a bat flying underwater. Foyle shot through the hatch into the dark side ballast hold. 2 minutes were gone. Like all spaceships, Nomad was ballasted and stiffened with the mass of her gas tanks, laid down the length of her keel like the long lumber raft, tapped at the sides by a labyrinth of pipe fittings. Foyle took a minute disconnecting an air tank. He had no way of knowing whether it was full or already exhausted, whether he would fight back to his locker, only to discover that it was empty and his life was ended. Once a week he endured this game of space poker. There was a roaring in his ears. The air in his space suit was rapidly going foul. He yanked the massy cylinder towards the ballast hatch, ducked to let it sail over his head, then thrust himself after it. He swung the tank through the hatch. 4 minutes had elapsed, and he was shaking and blacking out. He guided the tank down the main deck corridor and bulled it into the tool locker. He slammed the locked door, dogged it, found a hammer on the shelf, and swung it thrice against the frozen tank to loosen the valve. Foyle twisted the handle grimly. With the last of his strength, he unsealed the helmet of his spacesuit, lest he suffocate within the suit while the locker filled with air, if this tank contained air. He fainted, as he had fainted so often before, never knowing whether this was death. "Who are you?" "Gully Foyle." "Where are you from?" "Terra." "Where are you now?" "Space." "Where are you bound?" He awoke. He was alive.